हरिओम, विल स्टार्ट. प्लीज कीप योर वीडियोज ऑन. ऑडियोज कैन बी म्यूटेड. ओ ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै. ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः. ॐ श्री गणेशाय नमः. ॐ श्री सरस्वत्यै नमः. ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानाम् आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मवित्वरम्. परमात्माद्वयानन्दः सर्वभूतस्थितोपिह अज्ञानेनावृतो दृष्टः तथैव च मलोमलैः. सो फर्स्ट टॉपिक दैट वाज टेकन फॉर डिस्कशन बाय पूज्य गुरुजी वाज द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ प्यूरिटी ऑफ माइंड. व्हाई शुड वी प्यूरिफाई आवर माइंड? So we saw from different standpoints, from different ways, why we need to purify our mind. We also saw in the spiritual path itself, at every step, purity of mind is very much important. Even to begin the path, even to get that desire that I want to know myself, even to gain the knowledge, and even after gaining the knowledge, to be established in that knowledge, purity of mind is essential. That was the first topic that was taken. Then the second topic that we started in the last session was how to purify our mind. So he said that there are many sadhanas. Manashuddhikarani iha sadhanani vadanti. There are many sadhanas, many practices which are told for the purification of mind. What are they? Yajnaha, danam, tapaha. Then japaha, tirthayatra, vrata. These six sadhanas we have seen, and how they purify our mind, that also we have seen. But here in this text, which is called Manashodhanam, what is the main sadhana that is going to be discussed? That he explains in the next verse. He says, vichara sadhanam shreshtam. Vicharaha, enquiry. Thinking. This is going to be the sadhana. And why are we taking this sadhana? And why are we not discussing other sadhanas more? Yajna, dana, tapa, etc. are just mentioned. Why? Sadhanam shreshtam. Because it is the best sadhana. Oh. How do you know it is the best sadhana? Mahatvam tasya vai proktam krishnena swayamevahi. The importance of it, the greatness of it, of what? Of inquiry as the means for purification of mind is spoken of by Bhagavan Shri Krishna himself. Where in the Bhagavad Gita, so we saw two quotes from Bhagavad Gita. Nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitram iha vidyate. There is no greater purifier than knowledge. And second, bahavo jnana tapasa puta madbhava magataha. Bahavaha, many, many people who are purified by jnana tapas, by the austerity of knowledge, and have come and reached me. Bhagavan Shri Krishna is saying this, right? So inquiry is is the best means to purify the mind, and therefore that means, that sadhana we are going to discuss. Etat Bhagavatah Vakyam, this statement of Bhagavan, this discourse of Bhagavan, Swatma Shuddha Eka Siddhaye Vicharyate. Now I am going to reflect on it. For what? For a single purpose. What is that? Sva Atma Shuddhi. For one's own purification. This also we saw in the last class, how these Mahatmas, actually their teaching is to their own mind. And we listen to that and we start to imbibe those teachings for our mind. Right? So Guruji here says that I am not writing it for people or to be famous or I will have one more text under my name. No. Swatma Shuddhi Eka Siddhaye. Single purpose. What is that? So that my mind will be purified. Right? This is exactly what Tulsidas ji also says. If you have studied Ramayana, Tulsi Ramayana, he says that same thing. That I am writing this Ramayana for what? For my own purity. So that Nija Gira Pavana Karana Karana Rama Jasat Tulsi Gayo. He says, I am purifying my speech by singing God's glory. Purifying speech means what? Purifying mind. Right? So that's what he says. Vicharyate maya samyak. That now I am going to reflect on this statement of Bhagavan. Shri Harir me prasidata. May the Lord be pleased with my effort. This is what till here we have seen. Now when we are talking about inquiry as the means for purification of mind, we saw that there can be two levels, two ways by which inquiry can be conducted. First way is to reflect on the highest standpoint of the self and say that whatever emotions are coming, they don't belong to me. Why? Because I am that Supreme Self. Last time you remember, we saw the example of Ramana Maharshi. He used to follow that first method of inquiry. Anybody will come up with any emotional problem, anything, he will say, who is having the problem? I am having. Who are you? Gone. So the inquiry's focus is taken away from the emotions and mental qualities to who am I? This is one way. Now, everybody may not be able to do that. Why? Because to go to that level also, we need little bit of sadhana behind us. We need little bit of support. So those who cannot do that, for them, the second way is there. And what is that? Analysis. Reflect and analyze each and every emotion that you think is impurity in you. This is where we came. Now, when we are analyzing also, what are the things that we are going to analyze? We are going to analyze four things. What is that emotion? How does it get triggered? How does it express in me? What are the symptoms? And number four, what are its results? Now, I had given one homework. Remember? We took anger as example. And we said, let us in 1 week reflect on these four questions about anger. So now we will discuss that. Now you see, I'm sure you must have done some thinking and have come up with certain things. Now see if it matches. So what is the first question? What is anger? One thing we clearly know about anger is what? Anger is emotion of mind, which is not positive. Is this point established? It is not a positive quality. We have seen in the last sessions also, getting angry and showing anger are two very different things. Getting angry is never a positive emotion. Even if you are saying that I am getting angry for some cause or for something higher and not for selfish reasons, even then, getting angry is not a positive emotion. When we understand what the emotion is, please put this point clearly. Why? Because You see, we have been trained in a very different way. We have been watching movies, and according to us, angry young man is hero. You see, that has been established in our mind. So if suppose somebody gets angry, you feel, oh, hero. And some pavam person quietly will be walking somewhere, that cannot be hero. Why? Because he is not flashy. No, he is not showing anger. So it will take some time, but please put that thought clearly in your mind. Many people, after getting angry, boast that experience with others, saying that, you know what happened? I just got angry and I blasted. I just gave left and right. Careful. It is not a positive emotion. It's a negative emotion. Number one. Gurudev's quote also we had seen, that anger is a punishment that you give yourself for the faults of others. That's how he defines anger. He says, for somebody else has done something, now you punish yourself for it. That's what is called as anger. Which means what? Anger is a punishment. Careful. See what he's trying to say. Right? So anger is a negative emotion, number one. Now, what triggers anger? Now we need to, which our inquiry needs to be conducted in that. What triggers anger? On superficial level, you will say that a person or a situation triggers anger. Isn't it? Sometimes we say that, no, Swamiji, I will tell you, Veji, that person comes in front of my eyes, no, I start getting angry. The person probably has not done anything yet, is not opened his mouth or not said anything also. If that person just walks, you look at it and you start getting angry. And what do you say? He's not even smiling. Okay. Now tomorrow, if he smiles, look how he's smiling. Pavam, what should he do then? Should he smile or not smile? You make it clear, no? Why are you confusing? But no, sometimes we say one person's presence itself is anger for you. Or sometimes you say, somebody says something and that triggers anger in me. I've told 100 times not to say that, but still they say and it triggers anger. Some situations, you clean the whole house, you go for taking bath so that because you know you are very sweaty and all, and you come out and you see your children and your husband has again put everything at the place that it should not be. Then what? I just cleaned for 1.5 hours and Sunday one day I get and you don't allow me. Anger. So the situation triggers anger. Oh, this is, I'm talking very superficial level. That a person, some words, some situation, we think that that's what triggers anger. Now, think little more. Is the person triggering your anger, or is your expectation from that person that the person is not fulfilling is triggering your anger? He said something to me. Is that triggering anger? Or he said something to me that I did not want, triggered anger. Is the situation triggering anger, or is the situation which I don't like triggering anger? Careful. Think about this now. So what triggers anger? See, if anger is an emotion, is an emotion which is in my mind, the trigger has to be in my mind. Why? Because haven't we seen that when we are in good mood, even those situations where I should get angry, I don't get angry. Even the same person whose only presence triggers anger in me, doesn't trigger anger in me sometimes when I am in good mood. Words which usually make me angry do not make me angry sometimes, which means what? The trigger for that anger is not the person or the words or the situations. The trigger is my response to these three. And that response is dependent on why, what do I expect or what do I like? Careful. Now, this is called as inquiry. This is called as vichara. So, my son said something to me will not create anger in me unless I don't like what he is saying or I don't expect him to say something like that. So, where is the trigger in my expectation and in my likes and dislikes, of course? See, what is anger? We understood. What triggers anger? Our own expectation. I never expected you will behave like this. That is your problem. The person was planning to behave like this from years together. You didn't expect is your problem. Careful. So, I thought that you are my friend. You thought. What can I do if you thought? How many times I have told you I don't like it like this? That is also your problem. You don't like. I like to throw things there wherever I want. Now somebody will say, Veji, that means what? Whatever they do, should we allow them to do? That is not the question of discussion at all. I am not telling about that at all. I am saying you think what triggers anger. Is somebody's behavior triggering anger or is your expectation about that behavior triggering anger? My expectation triggers anger. My likes and dislikes trigger anger. My concepts, my ideas trigger anger. Why? Because sometimes I feel whatever only correct method. Think about this. How many times we do that? And therefore, if somebody else does it in other way, we don't like it. And the moment we don't like it, we get angry. Why? Because somehow I think that this is the only correct method. And whatever other people are doing is not correct. So my ideas, my expectation, my likes and dislikes are triggering anger. Now, what are the symptoms? When I get angry, what happens? Now, that will differ with each and every one of us, isn't it? But some things will be common. What? Our breathing speed will increase. Heavy breathing. Isn't it? Some people, if they are very fair, etc., they start getting red. Isn't it? Very interesting, you know. I like to observe, you know, when they get angry. Doesn't mean that I do something so that they will get angry. I am just saying that I like to observe. Somebody else has done something and the person is getting angry. The ears start to become red. Right at the top of the ears. So, for some people, the nose becomes red. For fair people, for people like us, there's nothing, no such symptoms happen. Why? Because we are not that fair. Nose. That's why in Marathi we say also that the anger is right on top of your nose. Doesn't look nice in English. Nakavar rag is better. Marathi only it's better. But you see, these are the symptoms. Then what happens? Suddenly we start sweating. We become hyperactive. Too many thoughts, too many things we want to do. These are the symptoms. Why should we know the symptoms? Because the moment any one of that symptom comes, we have to warn ourselves, get out of this place. Why? Because you are getting angry. If physically, if possible for you to get out of the place, get out. If not, mentally get out of the place. Think about something else. Why? Because the symptoms have started coming means anger will surely be there. And fourth question is what? What are the disastrous results? That we all know. One sure result of anger is what? Guilt. Regret. Isn't it? I get angry, I say something and after that I have to say sorry 1,000 times. Sorry, no, but I didn't mean it, you know. In my anger, I said it was not me who said it, but anger who said it. Oh, very good. Very good. Suddenly, we become philosophical. When? Afterwards. Not at that time. We break things physically also, and we break relationships mentally also. Isn't it? In that rage, in that anger, disastrous results. friendships are broken, years of friendships are broken because of one anger, one you know, mishap from your end, and that's what happens. Now, whenever you think about what anger causes, you will be more alert when the situations which make you angry arise. This is called as inquiry into anger. Now you see, the moment you start inquiring into it, you yourself will start getting the ways of handling that anger. We don't have to conduct class for that, saying that there are five ways. Number one, you do that. It's not required. Why? Because each and every one of us are different. And because each of us is different, what happens? Every single solution that I will give may not work for everyone. But if you yourself conduct inquiry for your own anger, you will surely get solutions which will work for you. See, I can say, you know, so many people have, and psychology, etc., also give so many solutions. If you are angry, go and take bath under cold water, sleep. Best method. For anything, sleep. If you are feeling so much of anger. But the thing is, when I am angry, I won't get that sleep. Isn't it? So what I am saying is, I am not going to tell you these methods, because that you already know. What I am saying, inquire. The moment you start inquiring, you yourself will get the solutions of how to deal with your anger. Nobody else has to give it. Right? Think about it. What triggers anger? Many times, inquiry will also help, because you can see some pattern in your anger. Pattern in the sense that these kind of situations, or in these situations, I become angry very easily. So then what happens? You be alert when such situations come. If you know there is a certain kind of behavior of certain kind of people triggers anger in me, of course, because of my expectations, then you are alert when next time it happens. We are going by which method? We are going by the method of inquiry. There are many other methods we have already discussed. Japa will help you in reducing anger. Meditation will help you in reducing anger. Vrata, etc. will reduce. But we are not going to discuss that. We are discussing about inquiry. We are going to discuss about thinking. Right? So, complete your analysis on anger. And then what? Then be alert. Don't expect that now that I have done analysis, so from tomorrow onwards, I will never get angry. Nothing like that will happen. But you will be aware of it. You will be looking at your own mind, what it does when it gets angry. You start to get some pointers as to how to come out of it. All right. So this is what is one example. Anger is just one example. What are the other emotions that we have, which we are calling as impurities? That is taken up now in the next verse. Right? Let us see. Will you repeat? Ragadveshadayah kamaha.
Ragadveshadayah kamaha.
Krodhalobhadayopicha.
Krodhalobhadayopicha.
Ahankarastatha swarthaha.
Ahankarastatha swarthaha.
Vividha manaso malaha.
Vividha manaso malaha.
Ragadveshadayah kamah krodhalobhadayopicha. Ahankarastatha swartho vividha manaso malaha. What? Vividhaha. These various manasaha malaha, impurities of the mind. Manasaha of the mind, malaha, impurities. What are they? Ragadvesha adayaha. Likes, dislikes, etc. Raga, attachment also you can take meaning out of it. Dvesha, aversion, hatred, dislike. These are the meanings of aversion, dvesha. Now again, careful, okay? Manasah malaha is said. He is not telling that these are the emotions in mind. Careful. Why? Because emotions in mind can be many other. Love is an emotion. Is not mentioned here. Why? Because it is not mala. Now, raga dvesha is mala. Why it needs to be told? Because we don't consider our likes and dislikes as our impurities at all. Isn't it? It is our common, what we say, topic of discussion. What do I like and what I don't like? And we match other people who have similar likes and dislikes, and that's how we get married, actually speaking. This, matching guna, etc. is gone now. Whenever we want to have friendship also with somebody, we see, oh, he likes Amir Khan, I also like Amir Khan, we are friends. It is dependent on like also. He doesn't like Shah Rukh Khan, I also don't like Shah Rukh Khan, we are friends. Dvesha also can be common point for friendship. Isn't it? And we boast these emotions. You know, I just don't drink any tea. The tea should be of this brand. Only Tata tea. I'm giving example, okay? I don't drink tea only. So, don't take it seriously. Otherwise, next time I will come to Mumbai, everybody will bring Tata tea to me. No, I don't drink tea only. I'm just giving example. But I only drink this kind of tea. And the other teas, I don't like. Coffee also, filter coffee only. Again, it is an example, okay? I don't drink coffee also. Example. In ice cream also, I have a particular flavor and particular company. And a particular person with whom I want to eat that ice cream. Everything is fixed in my life. And we say, you see, I only do like this. Other things, We don't realize that actually these likes and dislikes are impurities in us. Why? Why are they impurities in us? Because they create sorrow. Simple thing. See, the whole discussion we started where that we want happiness, isn't it? Now, what are these are the things that are creating sorrow in me. If you like only a particular flavor of ice cream and if it is not available, you will be sad. If the person with whom you want to eat that ice cream is not there with you, you will be sad. Likes and dislikes actually are, we will see in coming verses also, they are the source of all these emotions, other emotions. Anger also, just now when we were analyzing, we saw that our anger is also based on our likes and dislikes. Isn't it? If things that I like do not happen, I become angry. If things that I don't like happen, I become angry. Based on likes and dislikes. My desire is based on likes and dislikes. What I like, I want to have. What I don't like, I want to stay away. Want is born out of likes and dislikes. Anger is born out of likes and dislikes. All other emotions are born out of this like and dislike. Raga dvesha are the, what do you call, source of all these emotions. In Bhagavad Gita also, this is what is said. This raga dvesha, which becomes kama krodha, this is what is your problem, Arjuna. That's what Bhagavan says. Arjuna asks a question that people understand what is right, but they don't do what is right. Why? What stops them? Prompted by whom do they commit sin? Bhagavan says there is the prompter is not somewhere outside. The prompter is inside only. What is that? Kama and Krodha. That's what is said next. You see, Kamaha, Krodha, Lobha, Adaiha, Apicha. Kamaha means desire. See, the word kama in Sanskrit means desire. It can be any kind of desire, okay? Of course, sometimes that kama word is used in a particular desire of lust. That's also taken. So, lust, of course, is a mala. But we are talking about general also. Desire. And here, what do you mean by desire? Selfish desire is what is called as mala. So, either you can take the meaning of kama to be lust or selfish desire. I want that TV. I want this laptop. I want that mobile. Desire. Why it is mala? Simple reason, because it creates sorrow. See, think. Because it creates sorrow. The moment I say I want something, that want has created disturbance in my mind. And that's how I feel sorrow. Kamaha, krodha, we don't have to explain more. We just saw how krodha is a mala. Isn't it? Anger. Then what? Lobha. Lobha means greed. Greed. Mala. Very, very, very strong mala. Okay. In Bhagavad Gita, these three are called as three doors to hell. Trividham narakasyedam dwaram nashanam atmanah. Kamaha, krodha, tatha, lobha, tasmade tatrayam tyajet. 16th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan Sri Krishna says that these are the three doorways to hell. If you want to go to hell, you can go through either of these doors. And that three doors also will, you must have seen, no? One will be main big door and two small doors will be there. Kama is that big door. And two small doors are krodha and lobha. Desire, anger, greed. These are the three main malas, impurities that pull us down. See, hell means what? That which takes me downward. That which takes me away from my real nature. And adayah api cha means what? Generally in Vedanta Shastra, we speak of six enemies of us. We call it as shadripu. What are they? Shadripu, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya. Kama, desire, krodha, anger, lobha, greed, moha, delusion, misunderstanding, wrong understanding, confusion. All that is coming under moha. Mother, pride. Pride of what? What I have. And then sixth one is what? Matsarya, jealousy. These six are called as shadripus. These are our enemies. We keep searching for our enemies outside, but they are inside us only. And that's why it is easy for us to fight also. Because if they are outside, then we have to search. Where is the enemy? Where then they should be with us. Now these enemies are always with us. We can pick up fight anytime we want. Every time we want. Right? So these six, adayah api, includes all of these. Then what? Ahankara. What is the difference between mother and ahankara? Mother, pride is for what I have. Ahankara is the ego of what I think I am. Sometimes they speak of abhimana. Abhimana word, another word that they will use. See, Sanskrit is such beautiful language. See, mana means measurement. In Sanskrit, mana means measurement. That's why we say tapman. Measurement of how much heat it is. Don't we use such things? We use such things. Mana means measurement. Now, suppose I think that I am this much. This is my measurement of myself. I'm just giving example. Okay? So, this is mana. This is my measurement of myself. Now, suppose somebody else thinks that I am this much. And starts praising me. Oh, your singing is, you know, oh, you are the next Lata Mangeshkar only. What to say? Then what happened? Abhimana happened. Mana became abhimana. Now then thank you. Thank you. Then wherever we will go, we will say, hey, what were you telling about me? Please tell them also. I will listen. Why? No, I feel that I am greater. Now, similarly, if I think I am this much, and suppose somebody says that I am this much, then what happened? Upper mana happened. You see, mana, abhimana, apamana. Apamana means I feel insulted. How dare you speak like this? Do you know who I am? Who are you? You get down at this bus stop and ask anybody. They will drop you at my doorstep. Nobody will know. Try it. Go to that bus stop and ask. Nobody knows. Then they will say, no, that is because those people have come new. So what? Who are you? See, every single demon that is shown in our Puranas and Itihasas had this. Ravana thought that he is some big fellow, and therefore, while you see how that became the cause of their own fall. When Brahmaji came and said that you ask anything that you want, he said that I should not be killed by any devata, any asuras. Why? Because he thought that I am so strong, how can human beings even touch me? He considered human beings as so less. And that's what happened in later on. Sri Rama, as a human being, not only defeated him badly and killed. Not that by mistake Bhagavan's arrow touched. No, he was defeated twice. Bhagavan sent him back saying that, go, you are not fighting right today. Go and take rest. Come back tomorrow. We'll fight. And Ravana went. You read the Ramayana, you will see this. And next day he came, and next day Bhagavan fought and killed him. And with the help of whom? Monkeys. Which he thought can never touch me. Who are my enemies? My enemies are these devatas and these rakshasas and asuras, etc. Human beings, monkeys, what they will do to me? Abhiman. Fall. We start to fall the moment we have this ankar. We start to consider ourselves over others, better than others, holier than thou attitude, they say. Then in every single thing that we do, this is reflected. This attitude of ours, this feeling of ours is reflected in every single action of ours. We start to look down upon people and you say, I feel pity. Why should you feel pity? You feel their sorrow is one thing, but to feel pity is to say that, oh, he's so low, but I feel for you. I am going to remain in my position, but I feel pity for you. Who are we to feel pity? Eh? Who are you, that great personality or what? But we start to feel ahankara comes. Then what happens? Swartha, another mala. Selfishness. If really we start inquiring into our actions and into our life, we will recognize that 99% of our actions are selfish. Why I said 99? Because 1% by fluke, it becomes selfless action. Not that we do it, but it sometimes, by God's grace, sometimes we do it. Otherwise, most of our actions are selfish actions. Think about it. All our emotion, all our relations. Who remains connected to me? One who still gives me joy. The moment somebody stops giving me joy, I don't like that person. I don't like that person anymore. Why? Selfish. Again, selfishness is an impurity. Don't portray it as a good thing, See, I always, think about myself in this situation. Are you should think about other people. What do you mean you only think about yourself? Now, don't say that, okay, I am not selfish. Then what? I will do everything for others. And then what? Now, corona, so what? Corona is there. I will go out and help people. Is your help required? Don't you think that staying at your home only you are helping people? Stay at your home. No, but I want to, selfishness came in between. I want to do. You are doing it for your happiness. These are the impurities. That doesn't mean whatever is enumerated in this verse are the only impurities. Some examples are given here. You reflect, you inquire into your life, you will find many more. One example we had seen was fear. It's not listed here, but we know it's an impurity. So such many things will come up. These are the impurities. Now, to analyze these impurities, first thing is to understand where do they reside. Hindi mein bolte na, unka adda kidhar hai, adda. If you know the place where they are hiding, then you can attack them. From where do they operate? Unka headquarter, where is their headquarter? Where is their headquarter? Next verse. Let us see. Repeat. Bhuvanaji will repeat.
Yes,
Vijay. Ete sarve hi drishyante.
Ete sarve hi drishyante.
Chitte chalati jagrati.
Chitte chalati jagrati.
Pralinam chayada chittam.
Pralinam chayada chittam.
Naite sham drishyate gatihi.
नैते शाम दृश्यते गतिः
एते सर्वे हि दृश्यन्ते चित्ते चलति जाग्रति प्रलीनं च यदा चित्तं नैते शाम दृश्यते गतिः. See how simple language Guruji uses. Says एते सर्वे, all these what was explained in the previous verse as विविधाः मनसो मलाः, these different various impurities of the mind, ete sarve, all these drishyante are seen when jagrati, in the waking chitte chalati, when the mind is continuously in action, we see, means what, we experience these emotions, these impurities. So in the waking state, when the mind is functioning, we see them. Okay. Pralinam chayada chittam. But when the mind is pralinam, dissolved means what? When it is sleeping, in our deep sleep. Na etesham drishyate gatihi. Etesham, of them, of these impurities, gatihi, movement, na drishyate, is not seen. So in the waking, when the mind is functioning, I see all these impurities in me. In deep sleep, when the mind is dissolved, I don't see them. Means what? They reside in the mind. But Vedji, this we already knew. We were calling it as manomala from the beginning. No. You understand the implication now. The implication is, they are not integral part of me. If they are integral part of me, in my deep sleep also they should be there. When we are in deep sleep, we don't even know whether we are sleeping on bed or whether we are sleeping on rock. Yes or no? It's a different thing that on the rock, some people don't get deep sleep. That's a different thing. But once we enter into that state of deep sleep, we have no connection with the world. Where we all the other time, we keep saying that I want fan all the time on. Once you are in deep sleep, even if fan is off, you won't know. Forget about fan on and off. You won't know whether you are a man or a woman. How old are you? Do you remember? Do you experience any of that in the deep sleep? No. Anger, desire, greed, none of this I experience in the deep sleep. Which means what? These impurities are not integral part of me. And thus, we can remove them. See, if they are integral part of me, I will have to stay with them all the time. Now that I have understood that they reside in mind, they belong to the mind. And therefore, I can work on them and I can remove them. Why? Not integral part of me. Now, those of you who have studied Atmabodha text, immediately one verse will come to your mind, which is exactly like this verse. Rage cha sukha dukkhadi buddhau satyam pravartate sushuptau nasti tannashe tasmad buddhestu natmanah. Raga, Ichha, Sukha, Dukha, Adi, Buddho Satyam Pravartate. When the mind is awake in the waking, Pravartate, Sushupto Nasti. In the deep sleep, they are not there. Tannashe. Why? Because mind is not there. Kasmat. Therefore, Buddhehe. They belong to the mind, na Atmanaha, and not to me. All these Raga, Ichha, etc. Raga, Dvesha, Kama, Krodha, Ahankara, Swartha, all these impurities, they belong to the mind. Very important. They are not integral to me. So, do you mean to say that whenever we are in the waking and whenever mind is functioning, these impurities will be there? One more thing is required. What? Next verse. Let us see. Repeat. Jagrat. Picha vidvamsam.
Jagratta api vidvamsam.
Pidayanti nate tatha.
Pidayanti nate tatha.
Avidvamsam yatha lokam.
Avidvamsam yatha lokam.
Daya patram cha sarvada.
Daya patram cha sarvada.
Jagratya picha vidvamsam pidayanti nate tatha avidvamsam yatha lokam daya patram cha sarvada. Jagrati api. Now we said that in the waking when the mind is functioning, all these impurities are there. In the deep sleep when mind is dissolved, these are not there. Now he says one more condition. Even in the waking, jagrati api, even in the waking, vidvamsam te na pidayanti. Te means these impurities. Vidvamsam na pidayanti. They do not trouble. They do not persecute vidvamsam, wise people. Tatha means what? They don't trouble wise people like avidvamsam yatha. Like they, what we say, persecute avidvamsam. Avidvamsam, ignorant. What are they trying to say? No doubt we are saying that the emotions and impurities are there in the waking and not there in the deep sleep, and therefore they belong to the mind. Plus, you will be executed, persecuted, affected by them when you are ignorant. If you are wise, they may be there, but they will not affect you. Careful. It is not said that the for wise people, they are not there. No, emotions may be there, but they will not affect the wise people. Yatha avidvamsam pidayanti, tatha vidvamsam na pidayanti. As they affect the ignorant, like that they don't affect the wise. Which means what? If we want to get rid of these impurities, we have to become wise. Very simple. So one thing is that they belong to the mind. Now he just refines that definition and he says that they belong to ignorance mind. They belong to ignorance mind means what? Ignorant mind gets affected by these impurities. A wise mind or a mind of wise person is not affected by these impurities. And because ignorant people are getting affected, Pujya Guruji uses one word for them, daya patram cha sarvada. He says, always they are daya patram. They deserve pity. What do you mean they deserve pity? They deserve pity means pavam, they are ignorant. What can be done now? Now, towards you, how should you look at it? As long as I am ignorant, these impurities will take me for a ride. The moment I become wise, I will be the one driving. I will take them wherever I want. So, what are these two verses saying? Number one, these impurities reside in mind. In whose mind? In the mind of an ignorant. So, what is so? Therefore, next verse begins only with tasmat. Please repeat. Tasmad ajnanam evatra.
Tasmad ajnanam evatra.
Sarvada dukha karanam.
Sarvada dukha karanam.
Tatsvarupam hi jnatavyam.
Tatsvarupam hi jnatavyam.
Vicharena adhuna maya.
Vicharena adhuna maya.
Tasmad ajnanam evatra. Sarvada dukha karanam. Tatsvarupam hi jnatavyam. Vicharena adhuna maya. Tasmad, therefore, whenever word therefore comes in our scriptures, we have to understand that one topic is getting over. So the topic we started by discussing, where are these, what are these malas, where do they reside, that topic is getting over now. First he enumerated what are the malas, some examples are given. Then we said that these malas belong to the mind and not to me. They are not integral part of me, but they belong to the mind, and therefore we experience them only in the waking, not in deep sleep. Then we said that in waking also, whom do they affect? They affect only an ignorant and not the wise. Therefore, tasmad, what? Ajnanam eva atra dukkha karanam sarvada. Ajnanam, ignorance. Eva, alone, atra, here, in this context, ignorance is the only dukkha karanam, cause of sorrow. Sarvada, always. What? Ignorance causes these impurities. And these impurities will cause sorrow. Therefore, every single time I experience sorrow, what is the main cause of that sorrow? Ignorance. You remove ignorance, the impurities will no more cause sorrow. Careful. Impurities will not be there is not said. What is said? Impurities will not cause sorrow. Therefore, we say, no, wise person, yogarato va bhogarato va sangarato va sangavihina yasya brahmani ramate chittam nandati 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 eva. He may be with people yogarato va bhogarato va, in yoga, in the indulgence, or bhogarato, or in some indulgence, or yoga means in spiritual practices, or in bhoga, in indulgence. Sangarato va sangavihina, he may be with people, or sangavihina, without anybody, alone. Yasya brahmani ramate chittam, since that wise person's mind is focused on the supreme, nandati 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 eva, he rejoices and rejoices alone. He doesn't have any other. Means what? The emotions may be there, anger may be there, desire may be there, will not affect the jnani. Why? Because they will not be converted into sorrow. The moment we experience sorrow, what is the cause of that sorrow? The ultimate cause is ignorance. The immediate cause may be something else. The immediate cause may be that somebody said something to me, but you trace back. Why did I get offended because somebody said something to me? Because I expected them to be something else. My desire, that desire is born of likes and dislikes. Those likes and dislikes are formed because of ignorance. And therefore, ignorance is the ultimate cause of sorrow. That's what he's saying. And therefore, tasmad, therefore, ajnanam eva atra sarvada dukkha karanam. Ignorance alone is the cause of sorrow. Atra, here in this context, sarvada, at all times. But what should I do then? Tat swarupam hidnyatavyam. I must understand tat swarupam, its nature. Here it means what? Ignorance. I must understand the nature of that ignorance. Vicharena. How? Vicharena, through inquiry. Adhuna, now, maya, by me. So what should I do? By me, the nature of the ignorance must be known through inquiry. Why? Because the moment you start to inquire into ignorance, it vanishes. See how much our ancestors, our rishis have thought over all these things. There is a text called Naishkarma Siddhi. There it is said, Vicharam na sahate maya. This ajnana, this maya is there. Vicharam na sahate. It cannot tolerate inquiry. The moment you conduct inquiry, it vanishes. Isn't it true for even normal ignorance of ours? That I don't know something, the moment I start to say, what do I not know? I go deep, ignorance is gone, knowledge comes. Same is true for even the self-knowledge and therefore ignorance of the self also. The moment I start to inquire, it vanishes. In Advaita Makaranda also, similar thought is given. Ajnana is called what? Vichara abhava jivana. One who continues to live as long as there is no vichara happening, as long as there is no inquiry happening. The moment inquiry starts, ignorance vanishes. Right? So we must inquire into its nature, into the nature of ignorance. And then what will happen? Ignorance will vanish. So, what we have seen so far, all the impurities that we have seen, likes and dislikes, desire, anger, greed, etc., ego, selfishness, all of them, number one, they remain in mind. And therefore, they belong to the mind and not to me. They are not integral part of me. Even in the mind, when do they affect? When I am having ignorance of the self. The moment that ignorance is gone, the moment I am wise, though they remain, they do not affect me. Correct? Then, finally we said, therefore, ignorance is the root cause of all sorrow. So, sorrow which is caused by these impurities will be there only when there is ignorance backing these impurities. Ignorance is gone, these emotions may be there, they will not cause sorrow and therefore can no more be called as impurities. Right? You remember in the beginning also, we said that I am of the nature of Supreme Self, but I am not able to recognize it, experience it because of two problems, ignorance and manomala, impurities of mind. Remember? Now, their cause-effect relationship is established. That sorrow will be caused by the impurities of mind only when those impurities are backed by ignorance. So my actual problem is ignorance. And how will that go? By inquiry. The moment you start inquiry, it will go. Now, how from ignorance all these manomalas come out? That is the next topic, which we will be seeing in the next session. Okay. So the entire, what we say, tree diagram is given. Tree diagram. From ignorance comes this, then from there comes this, from there this. Everything will be covered in the next three verses. That we will see in the next session. Right? Sufficient for today. If you have any questions, you can ask. I think one question has already come that I will take and then we'll go to the next questions. How to develop selflessness as default setting? Change the setting. How should selflessness become? See, the method is seva. The more and more time we spend in seva, because seva is exact opposite of selfishness. And therefore, it is very funny when people say that I like this kind of seva, which is very funny because very purpose of seva is to give up likes and dislikes so that you won't be selfish. Right? So more and more we, seva is always for the other, isn't it? You are always doing something for the other. Now, of course, that seva can be towards your parents, towards the society, towards the community, towards the country, towards the humanity, towards the living beings. It can be towards everything. More and more we do, selflessness becomes our habit. That's what was the question actually, no? That how can it become a default setting? See, right now, our first thing that comes to our mind is selfishness. What am I going to get from it? What should I do for it? Now, when we start doing seva, by default, what comes is, what can I give? What can I offer? So this difficult time has come. There is some flood or corona, etc. So I will not think that, oh, I should set up one stall to sell masks. Right? I will get more money. No. I have to think, what can I give to the society? Seva bhava will create this kind of change in our thinking. Right? Okay. Next. Anandji, yes.
Hari Om Mahavirji. My question is a little bit of confusion because of verse 13, where we say that the wise person's impurities in the mind do not affect that person. So, does it mean that, you know, they also don't have zero impurity? And then, what is the role of purification of the mind? Or is it that for the wise person, the impurity is reached a manageable level and ignorance is not activating that impurity? You know, is this the difference?
See, any emotion is called as impurity when they generate sorrow. Otherwise, this distinction of positive emotion, negative emotion is of no meaning. What do we call as negative emotions? Finally, everything is emotion. But what are we calling as negative emotion or impurity? Anything that generates sorrow is called as impurity. Now, what is happening in case of wise is, those emotions may be there, but they don't generate sorrow and therefore they cannot be called as impurities. The emotions may continue to be there. Where? In their mind. And a wise has no connection with the mind, you see. He's not affected by it. To understand, car is there. My car. The moment I say my car, anything, any person touches the car, I feel that is touching me. This happens when the car is new for first 3-4 months. Okay, after that, it doesn't happen. But first 3-4 months, you park the car also in such a way that from window, you should be able to see where my car is parked. And therefore, any other person, even while talking to phone, just leans on your car. You shout from top, hey, how dare you? Why? Because you feel that much identity. Now, that has become cause of sorrow. After some time, what happens? Car remains separate. I am separate. You are finding ways that something will happen to the car so that I can apply insurance. Because for a long time, I have been paying to the insurance, but I have never applied for it. In case of wise, what happens is they look at their mind as something away from other than them. They don't consider when the mind gets angry, they don't say that I am angry. Why? Because they know I am not the mind. So the emotions may remain in the mind. They cannot be called as impurities. Why? Because they don't cause sorrow. So just like sattvic thoughts will come, tamasic also will come. For the wise, they don't try to change it. Why? Because they don't get affected by it. And because they don't get affected by it, it cannot be called as impurity. I'm not saying that emotions won't be there. Emotions will be there. Because mind, what else it will have? It will have emotions. Mind will go through moods. They don't get affected by it. Okay. But that doesn't mean they will have only these emotions. You see, they have reached that state after a lot of purification. Isn't it? So just like another question I was answering, their default settings only have been changed. And that's how they have reached there. So their go-to emotion will never be of this kind. Their go-to emotion will always be compassion, love. Why it is said like this here? Even if such emotions like anger, etc. exist in their mind, they will not affect their wives. That's what is the point. Doesn't mean that mind will have these emotions. No. That's not the point. You see, even in seeker's mind, when we are on the spiritual path and little bit of sadhana we do, even then our mind starts to become positive. And people around us also start to recognize that, you know, suddenly I become very quiet. It's not getting angry like before. Now, with seeker like us who are just beginners, this is the case. Now, imagine a person who has reached that level of knowledge. His mind will be absolutely pure. So, in that case, what will happen? Anger will be just to show. A person will not get angry. It's not possible for such person to get angry.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other doubt? If you have, you raise your hand, then I will know that you have doubt. No doubts? Reflect on this, okay? Whatever we have discussed, we took anger as example. But for you, there will be many other, for every all of us, for me also, there will be many other emotions which we consider as impurity. Then each of that needs to be analyzed with these four things. What is that emotion? What triggers that emotion? What are the symptoms? What happens to me? And what does it cause? What does it result into? Right? Reflect on that. All right. Shall we conclude? If there are no doubts, no questions. Okay. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. You can stop the recording, then I will do one.